Luke chapter 18, verse 8. I tell you that he will avenge them speedily. Nevertheless, when the Son of Man cometh, shall he find faith on the earth? Jude chapter 1, verse 3. Jude has only one chapter actually. Jude verse 3. When I gave all diligence to write unto you of the common salvation, it was needful for me to write unto you, and I exhort you that you should earnestly contend for the faith which was delivered unto the saints. Earnestly contend for the faith. I'm talking to us, I'm sharing with us on contending for the faith. Contending for the faith. Contending for your faith. Now, faith is a very critical subject matter. It is faith that brings us here today. There is no Christianity without faith. It is your faith that saved you, and it is your faith that will keep you going and keep you growing. Every one of us, the Bible says, he has given us a measure of faith. Why? Because God knows that without faith, there are so many things that we cannot do. If you read that scripture that I mentioned, if you read from verse 1 to 8, you discover that God just started. It's like a prayer verse when God said, men ought always to pray and not to faint. So what should men do all the time? Men should pray all the time. Men should pray all the time. And I say this, when it is going well for you, pray. When it's not going well for you, pray. When you come out of a challenge, pray. If you are about to enter a challenge, pray. If you are in the middle of a challenge, pray. The Bible says men are supposed to pray all the time, and they should not faint. The opposite of not praying is fainting. When you are not praying, you are also fainting. The Bible says we should pray and not faint. And it gives us an example that this woman went to the man's house, and she will knock and ask for something, and the man will not give her. She kept knocking and asking. And the wicked man said, if I don't give her what she wants, she's going to trouble me until I get tired of her troubles. And I didn't want to get tired of her troubles. So he answered her. So Jesus said the same thing, that if this man who is wicked can answer somebody, what about me? Me, that I'm called a good God. If I was going to preach the other message that I would have preached to us today, I've talked to us about God is good all the time. That's the truth. I had to get that into my system. Whether there was a lockdown or there was no lockdown, whether business was going or business was not going, whether things were doing the way I wanted them to go or they were not going the way I wanted them to go, whether I was enjoying the life I wanted to enjoy or I was not enjoying the life that I was enjoying, it doesn't matter what's going on. Honestly speaking, your negative testimony is not proof that God is not good. Because when the rain is not falling on you, the rain is falling on somebody else. That's a sign that God is good. Hello, somebody. If the rain is falling on anybody, somebody said, if you see your neighbor getting blessed, it means that God is in your neighborhood. He will soon get to you. So that things are not working for me is not an indication that God has lost his goodness. It doesn't have to be good with me for God to be good. No. It doesn't have to be. We must begin to settle certain things in our hearts because it's very critical. The God said, he said, the only problem is when I come, will I still find faith on the face of the earth? That's why the subject of faith is very critical. Many of us have to go back there. In the church today, I'm not talking about Joseph's Palace. Generally, we talk about every other thing because we need those things. We talk about so many subjects, but one of the things that we don't talk so much about is faith. I wish that we can have so many faith conferences like we have so many other conferences that we have. Faith conferences, where people can come in the place of faith and understand the depths of faith. Because without faith, it is impossible to please God. The Bible makes us understand. You read the book of Hebrew. By faith, this happened. By faith, that happened. By faith. The Bible says now, faith is the evidence. It is the proof that you place before God. The evidence of things that are not seen. So faith is your evidence. That's the evidence you have to stand before God. By faith. It's faith that works all things. So we must be building our faith. And the Bible says, if I've given you faith, because he says he has given us a measure of faith, you must contend for the faith, because everything that comes around you is coming to prove that God is not what God said he is. That's the fight. That's the fight we are having now. The fight is they are trying to prove that God is not worthy. Everything is coming to test that faith and to shake you and say, okay, let's see whether you can stand the test of time. But you have to stand, and you will stand in Jesus' name. So you've got to contend for the faith. Contend for the faith that God has given you. And the thing is, let me just answer some questions. You know, first of all, we are saved by faith, like I said, Ephesians 2:8, because I want you to take that down. We live by faith, Romans 10:17. We please God by faith. And then we see people who have also by faith acted out life. There are many of them, Gideon is there, just name them, Daniel is there. I mean, how can you enter the lion's den? You only enter the lion's den when you have strong faith that there's a God there. And they said to him, don't pray. And the man said, rather than not pray, I better enter the lion's den. Some of us, nobody has told us not to pray. It is we ourselves that have told ourselves that we should not pray. We ourselves. Many of us don't know that sometimes the challenges you have is what is waking you up to the place of prayer. I just remember the case. A young man who was in our church then when I was pastoring in Abuja came to church that day and he met me in the office. I mean, it was a very large church, so I couldn't even know 10% of the people. Very large. So he came in and somebody brought him to me and said, ah, he's one of our members. Okay, fine, what's the problem? They were about to sack him from the place of work and it meant a lot to him. He was shaking. You could see a man physically shaking. So I said, what's the problem? He said, this, that, that, that. When he finished narrating the prayer, I said, okay, that's good. Okay, what do you want? He said, you want that prayer? Okay, fine. So I prayed with him. And then he said, what's happening? He said, they've told him not to come to work. So I said, this is somebody that does not come for service. He only comes for Sunday. And even that Sunday, you see, you know, I have to rest for some time and then I'll come, you know. So I told him that on Sunday we're having a program at Nyanya. If you know Abuja a little bit, there's a place called Nyanya. Nyanya is quite far, it's out of town. I said, we're having a program, and he said, well, I would like to go with you. I said, hey, where do you want to go? He said, I just want to go, I need to pray. So I said, okay, fine, no, the program is at 5 o'clock, I'll be leaving here by 4:30. The man was in my office by 2 o'clock. 2 o'clock, so I looked at him and I laughed. Yeah. So because you have a problem now, you can now begin to look for God. Some of us, the only reason why you are holding on to God is because there's a problem. And if that is your mindset, sir, that problem will remain. Because if the problem is solved, we will not see you again. So if God loves you so much and he wants you around, he will keep you with the problem and he will help you to do management of the problem. May your case not become management of the problem, but the solution of the problem. So many of us don't know this thing, so we just play with it. If not that you have an issue, church might not be a place for you to come. Ask yourself, if not that there is a challenge, will you actually come to church if there is no challenge? If everything was working, will you actually come? If we call for a prayer meeting and you don't have an issue or you cannot see that you have an issue, would you come? Daniel was a big man and they told him, don't pray. And Daniel said, no, rather than not pray, I will pray and die than live without praying. Can I say that again? I rather pray and die than live without praying. And I can give you many examples. Let me not go there. So why is it that faith is cast? Number one, love for the world. And that's the truth. There is so much love for the world around the city. Now many, many of us have so much love. We are so enticed. So enticed. We need to break up the enticement. We are so enticed. We are so entangled with the cares of this world. So entangled, so held back, the shoe we wear. I was watching something the other day, and please, I don't use the pulpit to talk about people, but somebody just showed me something mistakenly, and a man was going to a place, so he opened the closet where he had his wristwatch, and they asked him, which of these wristwatches is your best? He said, oh no, it's not my best actually, but I like this one. This one is Rolex, this one is Roll-On, this one is Rolex. And this one is this. And then after that, I went to the place. And then the person said, ha, see shoe. And I saw the place laddered with shoes. I hope they hear me. Because I want them to hear me if they can hear me. Laddered with shoes. Excuse me, sir. If you don't have a proper self-esteem, you will use things to cover for your failure. That's the truth. We are so laddered with the cares for this world. You want to have 39 shoes, 40 shoes, 50. Can you wear two at the same time? Tell me, if you are mad enough, sleep in two rooms. If you are mad enough, sleep in two rooms. What do I mean? Sleep in two rooms at the same time. If you are crazy enough, drive two cars at the same time. Heaven will wait for you. Hell will receive you.
cares of this world. We are so conscious of the cares of this world that we cannot even look at the things that God is doing anymore. So all that kills us, all that buries us now is the cares of this world. And that is why your prayer is very simple. I can write your prayer point for you. Oh God, bless me. Oh God, prosper me. Oh God, I want to succeed. Oh God, I want to reach my goal. Your goal, not God's goal. Oh God, I want to reach there. Where is there? The place that you call there for yourself, not the one that God calls there for you. How many times have you remembered to pray that somebody should be saved? When last did you pray for a missionary on the mission field? When last did you pray for your neighbor and pray for someone else that you didn't know? When last did you care to reach out to someone else that has nothing? When last did you help somebody that will not be able to help you back? Cares for this world. And we need to rid ourselves from those cares. The clothes we want to wear, how we look, even on Sunday. They told me a story. As some people, they want to go to church on Sunday, sir. On Sunday, they want to go to church on Sunday. They will go to the bank on Friday to collect the jewelry they will wear. After Sunday service, they will go and deposit it back. On Sunday, they want to go to church. So you go and pick the jewelry, wear it, and then you go and deposit it back. Cares of this world. Every day you wake up, all you are thinking about, cares of this world. You've got to be careful because it will take your faith away. Number two is deceitfulness of sin. Sin looks good on the outside, but when you get in, you will know that it is deceptive. Very deceptive. It makes it look like, oh, it's going to be fine. It's going to be fine. But the moment it takes you, you will realize immediately that it was deceiving you in the first place. So be careful. How do we contend for the faith? Number one is the revelation knowledge of God. The revelation knowledge of God. You've got to come to a place where you know God for who he is, not for what he can do. You've got to come to that place where you can say, yeah, this is God, and I have a relationship. If there's anything that I care for now, is that God will be at the center of my life. And he will just be at the driving seat. He will be the center of everything that I do and everything I think about. When we are in a world when everything is, the only thing that is certain is uncertainty. What do you need? You need to hold on to it. You need to have God at the center so that the center can hold. And when you talk about revelation knowledge of God, you're talking about the two levels. Knowing God as a person and knowing God by his principle. The person of God is the one that shows you all the love that you enjoy. The principle of God is the way God works. Number two, love for God. Our love for God must be on the increase. If God loved us this much, the Bible says, should we not also love him? What does the Lord require of you? Deuteronomy chapter 10, verse 12. But he said to love him. So love is critical to your place of faith. Love God. Love God above all things. If I ask you what is your priority number one, I think that your priority number one should be God. And after that, other things follow. God must come first. God must come first. God must come first. God must come first. If not for social distance, I would have told you, tell your neighbor, God should come first. So I'm telling you three times so that you remember. If you didn't remember anything, as you are going, be remembering that I'm drumming it. God must come first in your life. Love God. Love God like crazy. Love God like mad. Love God. And let him know that you actually love him. Number three, obedience to his word. That's very critical. How did Abraham contend for the faith? By obedience. Obedience. God said, give me your son, the one that you love. And he was willing to release. See, anything that God gives you that you cannot release back to God is a problem. It's not a blessing. Let me say it again. Anything that God gives you that you cannot release back to God is a problem. It's not a blessing. So be warned. Be warned. Because if you can't release it, it can be taken away from you. So check it out. Obedience to whatever God is saying. And I want us to have that at the back of our mind. These are not times when we can be playing with God and playing church. And then maybe doing one thing on Sunday and doing other things on another. These are not the times. These are not the times. Those days are over. Those days are gone. We cannot afford to play those games again. There's no time for them because nothing is certain. You don't even know what's going to happen tomorrow morning. And now we know, at least we all know now, that we don't have all the answer. Even the president don't have the answer. Some people refuse to do what they are supposed to do when they're in leadership, and they are sweating for it today. That's why some people had to just pass on because everywhere was locked and the hospitals could not take care of them. Those are the same hospitals that they didn't build. The man that is talking about wristwatch and rocket man, he has cars that can't go to his village. And he's in leadership. No, he's not in leadership, he's in rulership. Because what we have now is rulers. We don't have leaders, we have rulers. That's a matter for another day. Obedience to what God is saying. If God puts you in a place and gives you the opportunity, do what God wants you to do. That's the glory of it all. Then fellowship with the believers. We must have time of fellowship. Times of fellowship. Anytime we have the opportunity, let's enjoy fellowship. And the last one is that we must keep up the banner of prayer. We must spend time in the place of prayer. I like that we have times to pray. Let's join up. Let's come in. We pray in the morning. We can pray in the afternoon. We pray all the time. God, the Bible says pray without ceasing. Let's come into the place of prayer. Let's pray. Let's give ourselves to prayer. Give ourselves to prayer. One on one, two on two, whatever the case may be. Let's give ourselves to prayer. Please, let it be a culture in our midst here. Let it be a culture that if you visit somebody, you don't leave the person's house until you have prayed. Can I get an amen in the house? Is that a good culture? Is that a good culture? It's a very good culture, I think. If anybody visits you and is a member of this church, even if it's an outsider, before they go, tell them, please, let us pray. So that if you have if you have gossiped, at least prayer will help you. He will repent quickly because he never can tell. Yeah, I know that when we visit each other, sometimes we gossip. We are human beings now, so it happens. So if you have gossiped, you say, let us pray. By the time you are praying, you remember that we gossiped. Oh, Lord, have mercy on us. Forgive us. Praise God. But let prayer be our lifestyle. And the Lord bless us in Jesus' name.